So last time we defined what is the meaning of a polyhedron or a simplicial polyhedron, namely a topological space which can be triangulated. And we saw that the disk is triangulable in such a way that the restricted triangulation to the boundary will give you the triangulation of the boundary of the boundary sphere. Let us take some more examples now. So recall that join of two complexes, the join of two topological spaces were defined as the quotient of x cross I cross y, in which at the zero end all the y1 and y2 are identified for each x, and at the one end, namely when the t equal to 1, all the x1 and x2 are identified with y keeping fixed. So that is the definition of the join. Okay, so what we want to show that is if x and y are triangulable, then its join is triangulable. So this is what we are trying to prove now. Okay. So this is a preparatory lemma here. If f and g are two simplexes in some simplicial complex, okay, then I want to say that the mod f star mod g triangulates, is triangulated by f star g. Remember, if f is a simplex, that means its finite set and all its subsets are taken, that is a simplicial complex. Then f star g is a simplicial simplicial complex on the disjoint union f and g. All subsets of this will be there, because they can be written as a subset of f union subset of g. Okay, so there are two different ways of writing f star g, or just disjoint union, and then take the full subcomplex here, take the modulus of that. That is linearly isomorphic to mod f, mod g, and then take the join. So this is the statement. Not only that, there is a very natural isomorphism. Namely, this map is first of all defined on mod f cross mod g cross t. Alpha t beta goes to t times alpha plus 1 minus t times beta. The standard construction that we have been following. Okay, so given alpha and beta inside mod f and mod g respectively, the RHS in the above formula belongs to mod f mod g, because you can think of alpha as a function on f disjoint union g taking value 0 on all points of g. Similarly, beta can be thought of as function from f disjoint union g taking value 0 on this one. So these two things can be thought of as functions here. Okay, and then they will be themselves points of mod f g. Then you can take the convex combination of that one inside this simplicial complex, inside this mod. This is a affine structure here. So that is the meaning of the right hand side here. Okay, therefore the FO assignment defines a function mod phi, phi from mod f cross I cross mod g to f disjoint union g, which is by the very formula, it's continuous because it's a affine combination. Moreover, it respects the equivalence relation on the domain. Okay, so what is the equivalence relation here? When t is 0, okay, when t is 0, all alpha is are identified irrespective of what beta is for each beta. So this will give you d beta. When t is 1, all the beta are identified. So this will be again respects the relation. Okay. So this gives a, so it gives a function from mod f star mod g, which is the quotient of this one, to f. whatever is identified here goes to the same corresponding point here. They have, that's why this is a map here. Obviously, by the definition of quotient topology, this will be continuous now. Okay. So, point that we have to verify is that this is a bijection. The moment is a bijection, this is a compact space, this is a Hausdorff space, it will be automatically a isomorphism. It is a homeomorphism. It's a linear isomorphism, linear in the sense of affine linear, not the vector space linearity. So what I will now leave it to you is, this phi hat is a bijection. Okay, this is simpler than what we did the last time, namely for delta n. Okay, so you can just verify it. Take alpha prime beta prime, okay, and take this formula. Suppose phi of here itself, phi of, you know, this is equal to phi of some alpha prime t prime beta prime, then show that they are equivalent, so that the two points are equivalent. That will give you injection here. Injectivity here is not true. Injectivity is here, okay, and surjectivity is obvious because everything can be written as one point here and one point here, p to n. This is more easier here than in the case of mod delta and beta and so on. Okay, so this is an exercise for you. Okay, so there is a canonical word here, canonical affine linear isomorphism. What is the meaning of that? I don't want to explain that one. This is explanation only. It requires no proof at all. Namely, suppose you have F1 is a subset of F, G1 is a subset of G. Then you have the following commutative diagram. Mod F1 star mod G1. The same phi hat going to modulus of F1 disjoint in G1. This will be a subset of that. So modulus of this will be a subspace of this. This will be a sub, each of them is a subspace. So F star G will be containing F1 star G1. So these are inclusion maps. Again, phi hat is here. This diagram is commutative. So structure here, phi hat, is same thing as here because they are given by the same formula, T times alpha plus 1 minus T times beta, whether you are here or here, whether you are here or here. That's the meaning of this. Okay, but this is an important thing, this property. All right? So that's why I have mentioned. So now we can complete the task of showing that modulus of K1 star K2 is homeomorphic to modulus of K1 joint modulus of K2. As such, you don't know whether this is a polyhedron. Once you prove that, it follows that this is a polyhedron. That is a volatile. Okay. So once again, recall that the vertex set of K1 star K2 is the disjoint union of the vertex set of V1 and V2. But what are the simplices? Simplices of K1 star K2 are disjoint union of a simplex in K1 and a simplex in K2. Okay, therefore, this mod K1 and K2 are subspaces of modulus of K1 star K2 in an obvious way because they are there. Simplex is here. Okay, so moreover, if alpha is in F1 and beta is in F2, then one T times alpha plus 1 minus T times makes sense in F1 disjoint in F2 itself. Okay, you don't have to go outside. F1 disjoint in F2 has a affine structure. So that is contained inside K1 K2, K1 star K2. Therefore, the same formula that we have done will work here also locally at each, for each F1 and each F2 in a small one. And if you from smaller one to larger one, when you pass, the formula on the smaller one doesn't change. They are compatible. So that's what we have noticed here. okay, in this one. Therefore, you can put them all these phi hat together, which is defined for each F1 and F2. That will define a single homeomorphism phi hat from mod K1 star K2 to this one. Because corresponding images will be also distinct. If F1 and F2, G1 and G2 are different, then their interiors will be different. The boundaries will agree with the smaller simplices. Therefore, this itself is a homeomorphism. Okay. In particular, you specialize K2 to a single point. This is nothing but the cone. If you take two points, it will be suspension. So we get both suspension and cone of a polyhedron will be polyhedrons. Suppose X has already some structure, namely of a polyhedron, then the suspension of that will also have a polyhedron, namely X star S naught. Mod of X star X naught will be SX. That is the, so we can define the suspension of X also as a in the case of polyhedron. Okay. In particular, we have also observed that if you repeatedly take the join of S naught with itself, N plus one copy, then it's the sphere. So this will give you another simplicial structure to SN than what we have defined in the previous section. Okay, this point I want to repeat it. It is, once I have said it, it's over, but I want to repeat it. This is called extrangulation of a sphere. Okay, this special case I am going to explain now here. So this is an interesting way to triangulate the sphere. We have just seen that the topological cone over Sn minus 1 is homeomorphic to Tn. So if follows that, if Kf is a triangulation of X, then the triangulation of X extends to the cone. So this capital F is a triangle extension of the map, not a simplex. Okay. Since the suspension can be thought of as a double cone, it follows that we get a triangulation Sk Sf of Sx. This is a more general statement I am making. But here, already we have observed that S naught, K times will give you the sphere. So I come back to that one now. Recall that Sn can be thought of as n-fold suspension of S naught. In particular, beginning with the obvious triangulation of S naught, what is it? Just two point, that's all. Vertex set, zero dimensional simplicial complex. Okay. By taking successive suspensions, we get a triangulation of Sn. Okay. So we shall refer to this as triangulation of Sn by S triangulation, mainly by taking suspension. It's worthwhile to note that the antipodal map in this case, namely antipodal mappings of alpha x is minus x, is a simplicial isomorphism of the triangulation. Okay. If you take the standard boundary of delta n, antipodal map has no role to play there. It is not that easy. Okay. So S triangulation has this property, and that is very useful. I will give you some more examples here. Now consider the one-dimensional simplicial complex K, whose vertex set is a set of integers, 1, 2, 3, and so on, 0, minus 1, minus 2, and so on. Okay. And the edges, namely one simplexes, are precisely consecutive integers, n and n plus 1. N plus 1, n plus 2, like that, consecutive integers, nothing else. So this is simplicial complex. Okay, what is its geometric realization? It will be the whole of R. Each simplex, n to n plus 1, filling up the gap between the interval n to n plus 1. So that's it. Okay. So this way we get a triangulation of R. The point here is, this is the first triangulation that we have taken to be infinite. Okay, a genuine example. Otherwise, we had only disks and delta ends and so on. Okay. The triangulation here, the simplicial complex K could not have been finite, because if this were finite, then it will be compact, whereas R is non-compact. Now I come to a serious problem, namely products. We have already dealt with some way product with I, but you have to be careful. There it was for the join. It was not actually the Cartesian product of a space with some other space, okay? The problem is, what kind of polyhedron will, what kind of simplicial complex will give you the product structure? Suppose X and Y already have polyhedrons, then is there a way to give a product a polyhedron structure such that it has something to do with the original original complexes on X and Y? So this problem is much deeper and quite difficult. In fact, in general, it is not possible. So what I will do is, I will specialize to the case when one of the factors is just the interval 0, 1. Even here, we will have problems. For example, take delta 1 cross delta 1. What is the best way to triangulate this one? There are two vertices here, two vertices here. So you are tempted to take four vertices. Then for each one simplex here, zero simplex cross one simplex, one simplex cross zero simplex, and so on. Okay. If you do that, okay, what happens is that the number of vertices taken four is lucky. That's right. But the number of simplexes are too many. So this is depicted here in this picture. So V naught, V1 is delta 1. V1, V2 is also delta 1. So this is a product. Okay, this is I cross I. The product space is I cross I. But what is the simplicial structure here? I can take 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1 as vertices. But then how do I take, what are the, what should be the simplexes? Naturally, the subspace, this one, this one, this one, this one must be there. But then if you just leave it there, the interior is not a simplex. So you have to either cut it this way, or cut it this way, right? Both of them are possible. The fact that there are two different choices creates a problem. Which one to take? The moment there is a choice, that is going to create a problem. Okay. So, we want to solve this problem in a canonical way by introducing a little more number of vertices and more edges rather than just sticking to just products, things like this. Okay. So this is what I want to do. So this is point cross I. Okay. The point cross I itself is a simplicial complex. Okay, because I is a simplicial complex. I is just one simplex. But I am not going to leave it like that. I'm going to divide it into two parts by taking the bare center of this one as extra vertex and then declaring these two portions as simplexes. The original simplex 0 to 1 disappears. It has been cut. That is the meaning of it. All right. So come to the second case, namely when it's delta 1. So this is delta 1 cross I. Mod delta 1 cross I is a rectangle or a square, whatever you want to think of. Point cross I is this one, so it disappears here. Other point cross I also disappears here. Delta 1 appears as it is at the zeroth level as well as at the 1 level. So now you have this big square here, empty square. So what I'm going to do is, I take the barycenter of this one, shift it at the half level. That is going to be an extra vertex. As soon as you have extra vertex, join it to all the vertices in the boundary. Join it, if this is simplex, declare this as simplex. If this is simplex, declare it simplex. Namely, this is the cone construction. Do the same thing for delta 3 also. So this is, this is delta 2. There are two simplex. once you have fixed what the boundary is, which is a one dimensional part, one cross I, okay, or the boundary is fixed, the bottom is kept as it is, so the whole boundary of delta 2 cross I has been triangulated. Take the barycenter of this simplex, shift it at half, and then take the cone over that. So having told this one, actually the construction of what I call as the prism construction. Why I'm calling it prism? Look at this one, this delta cross I, this is the prism. This is called the prism construction, is over. Let me do it systematically once again, so that you will understand what is going on. So for each simplicial complex K, we shall construct a simplicial complex denoted by K cross I. This is a notation. This is going to be a simplicial complex which I am going to describe. K is a simplicial complex. K cross I, there is no simplicial structure yet. Okay, if you take mod K cross I, that is a topological space. All right, this K cross I is just a symbol here, but I am going to call it prism only after I construct the simplicial complex on this one, which I am going to describe. So this is called prism over K, like cone over K we have constructed, and the suspension over K. So this is prism over K with the following properties. Modulus of K cross I, the underlying the geometric realization is mod K cross I. This is the first property. Okay. Then there are simplicial maps eta 0 and eta 1 from K, which is simplicial complex, to this simplicial complex. So this is a simplicial map. Okay. Which are isomorphisms onto subcomplexes. That means they are 1-1 mappings, taking simplexes to simplexes in a 1-1 way, which the images will be denoted by K cross 0, image of eta 1 will be K cross 0, image of eta 0 is K cross 0, eta 1 is K cross 1, okay? This is a notation, okay? Just like K cross I is a notation, is K cross 0 and K cross 1 are notations, and they are subcomplexes of K cross I. Okay, this is the property I want. I want A, I want this property B also. I want something more, namely the underlying topological space of K cross 0 is mod K cross 0 and K cross 1 is mod K cross 1. So this is the property C. Finally, I want, if you take a subcomplex L of K, then I must have L cross I also, the prism over L. This must be a subcomplex of K cross I, the whatever I am going to define. And neither I have defined L cross I, nor I have defined K cross I, but they must have this property. So I want a prism to have all these properties. Okay. Now, I have put so many conditions, it looks like too many restrictions you have put made your life more difficult. In reality, these restrictions will actually guide you how to construct Kekrasaya. And that is done by induction. Okay. So let us have notation. Beta F will denote the barycenter of any simplex. Okay. Let us put F hat, short notation, for the ordered pair beta F comma half belonging to mod F cross I. Okay. So I am placing this barycenter at the level half. Now, suppose F is a single vertex. Okay. Zero simplex. Then I am looking at a simplicial complex with vertex set precisely equal to this one, and one simplex is set precisely equal to this one. Okay, and this is the simplicial complex. There are no other two simplex, three simplex, and so on. This is going to be my F cross I, where F is singular. Okay, so what are the vertices? V0, V1, and V½. That is precisely this picture, the first picture here. Okay. And V0, V½ will be one simplex, and V½ and V1 will be another simplex. Okay, so that's what I have listed here. V1, V½, V0, and V1. And eta 0 of V is just V0, eta 1 of V is V1. Okay. Now, this completes the construction of F cross I when F is a singleton. Since there are no subcomplexes, subcomplex is empty, all those A, B, C, Ds, whatever I have demanded, they are all satisfied. Okay, so the construction for singleton is over. As soon as you have constructed singleton, you take the union of all these things. It will be constructed for all zero-dimensional simplices. A zero-dimensional simplex is nothing but union of singletons. So the construction is over for all zero-dimensional simplices because I am just taking the union. Okay, singleton cross I, disjoint union, because singletons are disjoint union over K. Okay. So the inductive step is over for n equal to 0. Now assume that we have done it for some n minus 1, all the way up to n minus 1. Okay, then we want to do it for n. What is the meaning of that? Take a simplicial complex k and take a simplex n, an n dimensional simplex in it. On the boundary of this simplex, there is already a structure. Boundary of this simplex cross I, there is already a simplicial structure. On the bottom, K cross 0, F cross 0, I am not going to disturb it. I am keeping it as F. F cross 1, also I am not going to disturb it. I am keeping it as F cross 1. So this way, I complete the picture of mod F cross I and its boundary. The boundary of mod F cross I is already given a simplicial structure. Now you take the cone over this with the cone point, namely apex point, precisely at F hat. F hat is what? The barycenter of F comma half. Okay, so that's what I'm going to do. So BF cross I is already triangulating boundary of F cross I. So that's modulus of BF cross I is boundary of F cross I. This is by induction. Okay, so you should know that F is we know already is homeomorphic to DN. So f cross I is homeomorphic of dn plus 1, right? So dn plus 1 is a cone over its boundary Sn. For this, we are using it here. So we simply take f cross 0 as it is, f cross 1 as it is, they are copies of f, union bf cross I, okay? So this entire thing from here to here describes the boundary of mod bf cross I. So that has been given the structure. Take the cone over f hat. Take the cone over this f hat as the apex. Okay. So automatically, the extension of eta naught and eta 1 over this one is over, because now the f is sent to the corresponding f, that's all. Okay. Once you have done it for one simplex f, n simplex, one of them, do it for all the n simplexes. Exactly same way. Take the union of n minus one simplex, we have already constructed. Take the union over all the n simplexes. That will complete the construction for n-dimensional skeleton kn cross I. Okay. So inductively constructing n minus 1 skeleton to n skeleton we have described. Therefore, now the construction is over for all kn cross I, where kn denotes the n skeleton of k. Take the union of all these things. Because of the property D, they are compatible. The subspace which is already triangulated extends the triangulation when you go to larger space. Gets extended. So they will be compatible. So take the union, that will be the definition of K cross I as a simplicial complex, which will have its modulus homeomorphic to mod K cross I. Okay, this is prism construction. All right. Let me give you another simple thing, is a triangulation of a torus. By the definition, you must be knowing that torus is defined as S1 cross S1, but S1 is defined by the interval and identifying endpoints. Therefore, the torus can be defined by identifying opposite sides. Okay, a pair of opposite sides will be identified with the correct orientation. Okay, so this you must be knowing already. So, in order to give a triangulation on the torus, what we do is we choose a triangulation on the I cross I in such a way that when you quotient out, the triangles, etc., don't collide. In other words, two vertices which are joined will go to two distinct vertices corresponding there. Three vertices which have a triangle, they will go to a triangle. Not that the two endpoints of a triangle, the vertices will be identified and so on. Okay, not only that, another set of edges will not come on the same set of vertices. This is what you have to be careful about. All right. So all this thing is done. So this is a good example to know when you have quotients, what you have to be careful. So we cut down the I cross I triangle along each one, divide it into three portions. So this is good enough for triangle. See, if you identify these two endpoints, you get a circle. The circle, minimal way of triangulating a circle is take three points and three edges, right? You can't do less than that. So do that. 1, 2, 3. This is one only because this is going to be identified with this one. Now take some more vertices, 4, 5. Okay. But then again, this will be identified, this one. So this is one. But three will be identified, this three. Two will be identified, this two. one would have this one, this entire line being identified with this entire line. 1, 2, 3, 1, 1, 2, 3, 1. Similarly, 1, 4, 5, 1, identified 1, 4, 5, 1. So these are new, not new, but inside I am taking 6, 7, 8, 9 here. And then joining them very systematically like this. This is not a unique way, there may be many ways, okay? Now you see, each triangle is uniquely defined when you go to the quotient. So this gives you the triangulation of a toroid. This is not an economic way of doing it, by the way. Given any surface, you can give a triangulation that is a little more harder to prove. It is a big theorem. And then there are problems like this. What is the minimal number of vertices needed? What is the minimum number of edges needed and so on? This is a big industry since several, almost 30, 40 years now. A lot of people are working. One famous mathematician in India has worked his life on that, namely Professor Basudev Datta and Sarkaria in Punjab. Basudev Datta, it's IISc, and some of his students and so on. Okay. The torus itself can be triangulated by using just 7 vertices. Try to do that. Let us stop here.